He's got some lunch, some coffee. My name is Carol Peden. I'm the Executive Director of the Center for Health System Integration. And on behalf of my center and the USC Institute for Integrative Health, I'd like to welcome you to this seminar on the role of guided imagery in health and healing. I think we've got an excellent session, very exciting, very important both for our patients and probably for ourselves. And as many of you will know, it's important that staff look after themselves as well, because that directly reflects on patient care. But I think we're going to hear a lot of interesting evidence about the use of these techniques for patients. So we have our keynote speaker, who's Belleruth, Naparstek. And then we have Dr. Marc Weigensberg, I can never, sorry Marc.
No problem.
And then Tveen Kirkpatrick. So we have a range of speakers for you, all experts in their field. Our first keynote speaker is Belleruth, Naparstek, and I think we're very privileged to have her here. She's a psychotherapist, an author, and guided imagery pioneer. She's an author of a number of books. I don't know who's banging on them. Somebody's, I don't know if the mic's lucky, but so her first book was called Staying Well with Guided Imagery. And her most recent book is Invisible Heroes, Survivors of Trauma and How They Heal. So she's doing a lot of work with veterans and survivors of with post-traumatic stress disorder. I think she's going to tell us a lot more about her work, but I think we're very lucky to have her here, and I think it's going to be a very interesting session. Thank you.
Yeah, let's see if this works. So, thank you for having me here. I'm delighted to be here. And since this last wave of fat shaming that's been going on in our politics, I've started introducing myself as, I'm Belleruth Naparstek, I'm 73 years old, and I'm 162 pounds. I think if we all introduced ourselves in this way, the fat shaming would be over soon. Okay, but that's neither here nor there. I'd like to talk about guided imagery. I'm going to be talking fast because I have a lot of information and I don't want to step on my colleagues' time. But just to define it a little bit, it's a very simple, user-friendly kind of directed daydreaming that gets administered, usually with words and music, to an end user, a listener. It's designed to drive attention inward and sort of create an internal healing story that people can respond to. It's not strictly visualization. It's multi-sensory imagery using all of the senses. Only 55% or so of the population is strongly wired for visual memory and fantasy. The rest of us use audio, smell, sight, taste, kinesthetic sense. And guided imagery attempts to use all of them in a kind of scattergun approach so that something will ping on somebody's nervous system. And it is considered the lazy person's meditation because it requires almost no expertise, training, discipline to have it work well for people. So you don't even have to be awake for it to work. And one of the things I like best about it is it works very well as a complementary therapy for whatever else you're doing. It won't step on it, it will not compete with it, it will not undermine it. It will actually support it and increase motivation. Okay, so who is it especially good for? The piece that's most appropriate for here is it's for patients who are facing anything that makes them anxious. A medical procedure, surgery, dialysis, a biopsy, ventilator weaning, it doesn't matter what. The more anxious the person is, the better they use it, which would not have been my first guess. And it's one of the few times, pre-surgery for instance, when there is an equal number of male adopters to female. People with emotional challenges, that's sort of like what I started doing this for. I'm a therapist by training, so it's very good for certain conditions, certainly anxiety, depression, self-esteem, panic attacks, and it's particularly good for post-traumatic stress, which is stashed away in a different chunk of brain than what happens, than what gets hit with talking, analyzing, thinking. So it is, post-traumatic memories are in the primitive survival-based parts of the brain, and that's where guided imagery goes, and language doesn't. It's good for wellness, people seeking lifestyle tools. It's a good tool. It helps people sleep better. We've got data on it. Weight loss, smoking cessation, and people in pain. It's great for people in pain. There are just hormonal shifts that create pain-relieving endogenous biochemicals. So it's also good for people with Alzheimer's and dementia. Again, because it goes to parts of the brain that are still active and available. Am I talking too fast? Because there's no point. It's proven for cardiac patients, hypertension, diabetes patients do particularly well with guided imagery. There's a ton of studies on that, both just daily blood glucose levels and hemoglobin A1C. It helps with breathing and asthma, COPD, hospice patients with cancer. It just slows people down so that there's not an additional anxiety to the breathing. And it's terrific for rehab. That's actually where most of the studies are coming from these days. It's on stroke, TBI recovery, Parkinson's, a lot of studies showing that guided imagery fires the same nerve cells that you get with actually doing stuff, only it doesn't hurt, doesn't cause pain when you do it imaginably. Very, very good for increasing range of motion in arthritis patients, and just basically it gives people a sense of mastery, control over their fate, like they're empowered to have something under their control that they can deploy when they want, if they want, how they want. So, any contraindications? Yeah, not a lot, but it should not be imposed. This is the main one. It should not be imposed on anybody who can't stand the technique. And there's about 10% of people who will not like it. It can make them more anxious, more agitated if they have to sit still and relax and listen to somebody's guidance. So. Those people, there are plenty of other great things they can do. They do not have to listen to guided imagery. There are some people with post-traumatic stress who will get triggered by a soft, low voice, reminding them perhaps of early childhood abuse or some other thing. And again, they should not have to do this. They know that's what God invented the pause button for, is to stop. And for people who are triggered, simple breath work, simple progressive relaxation. It's a nice body movement relaxation and stretches with yoga or biofeedback can be great. And it's not recommended for anybody with severe mental illness who's actively. For instance, somebody with bipolar illness who's cycling. Okay, why do people like it? This is the good news. People feel different immediately. They will be more relaxed. Their breathing will be slowed down. Their voices will be lower. They'll just feel more comfortable. Their pain sometimes goes away just from the serotonin-like hormones that are floating around. Anybody can use it, as I said. It does not require any special skill. It's self-administered and it's private. And for a lot of people, that's really important. Because we do a lot of work with veterans and active duty armed service personnel. It really matters a lot that they can be listening to something for their panic attack, and it looks like they're just listening to music. It's available 24/7. This can be a blessing. This can be a blessing for certainly the patient. It can also be a blessing for the healthcare provider who does not get an extra call because someone is anxious. So, but it's wonderful for people. We're talking to the California Community College system about using this for anxious, stressed out students who really need something in the middle of the night, and they do not have enough staff and health services to go around. It's portable and handy. It uploads to a phone or a listening device, and because of that, it can be part of somebody's life. It can fit seamlessly into their life. They don't have to do a whole structured protocol to have a certain time and place. And in the hospital, it can shut out irritating noise. Okay, so practitioners like it because it complements other treatment methods, but it does not compete with them or undermine them. I think I said that already, so I'll just move right on. It's important to be able to frame this not necessarily as a healing intervention, but as a skills training, using an educational model as opposed to a medical model, just because some people don't like that idea, but they're perfectly comfortable with the idea of I am acquiring a new skill set for my life. And of course, it delivers the same reliable intervention every time, doesn't change. And it regulates the mood and pain of the patient. And especially on a floor, if a patient has access to this, it's going to reduce anxiety-related calls, especially for nursing on the floor. Okay, so I want to briefly talk about this study with 335 pre-surgery patients testing the efficacy of what started out to be four different audio interventions administered before and during some very complicated 7 to 9 hour surgeries. It was at UC Davis, down the road, well, I guess considerably down the road, and Penn State, even further down the road. And the outcomes measured blood loss, length of stay, pre and post-op anxiety, and analgesic and morphine use. So these were cassettes too. This was done in the 90s. So there was this instructional tape. It wasn't just instruction, it was pretty cognitive, but it was also done in a very soothing, relaxing voice, and it was Henry Bennett saying, this is what you can anticipate, and the idea being, knowledge is power. If you know what's going on, you will do better with your surgery. There were affirmations by Linda Rogers, beautiful affirmations by the daughter of Richard Rogers. Binaural, hemi-sync tones by Robert Monroe. I don't know if any of you are familiar with those. They were very big in the 70s, but it's basically alternate tones driven into each ear, and it basically just pushes the brain into a state of mechanical relaxation. It's pure relaxation, and it's content-free. There's nothing but relaxation here. We were thrown in at the last minute. I met Henry at a conference. He said, I hear you've got something for surgery, some guided imagery. Can we use it for a study? So I was thrilled, so sure. Then for his control, he had what he called pink noise, these whooshing sensations that go into the ear for placebo control. And then he added another group who did very well. And these were people who got an audio cassette and never listened to it. So they performed nicely with this. Okay, so I don't know if you can see this, but basically, the most relaxed people were the, I believe, the Monroe people. But they also were the people who bled the most. So they bled 500 cc's as opposed to the controls, which were 350, as opposed to the guided imagery, which was relaxation plus a directed suggestion, which was 200. So the point I like to make with this is, a lot of people describe guided imagery as being relaxation. It is relaxing, but it is not just relaxation and should not be confused with just relaxation. Anyway, and length of stay made a difference too. Of course, I'm not sure what that statistic would look like now, because people don't stay as long as they used to. And use of pain medication was a lot less. So, the blood loss was the most dramatic result. And basically, when Henry called me to say, are you sitting down? I want you to hear this result. I couldn't even remember what I had on the tape about blood loss, because I had written it a while ago. So I want to play you what it said about blood loss that reduced the average by so much. So what am I doing? I shouldn't be doing that. Okay, so here's the suggestion. It comes two-thirds of the way through this immersive, hypnotic, relaxing imagery. And it's not even a full sentence. So let's see if I can get this for you.
A smile, non-mature reflection.
Can we make this louder?
Some looking familiar.
Is that too loud?
Seeing perhaps the faces of some of those who love you from the past, the present, the future.
I should say that people have envisioned being in a calming favorite place. They see a screen appear, that on the screen there's an OR. I was just trying to get as much distance between the listener and the surgery so they wouldn't freak out listening to this, remembering they were about to have surgery. So they're in a favorite place, a screen appears, and on the screen they see themselves being wheeled into an OR. Okay.
Filling up the entire room. Wishing you well, looking after you, proud of your courage, pleased you're taking this step to be as strong and well as you can be. One of them looks steadily into your eyes and nods with quiet confidence as you move into deep sleep. Or perhaps for this surgery, just a physical numbness takes over. Safely and easily. You watch as the team surrounding you works over you, and perhaps they even express surprise at how well things are going, at how easy it is to do what's needed, at how cooperative your body is being, even slowing down the blood flow to make the work go more smoothly. So just feeling gratitude for this body of yours.
So that was it. And it was listened to an average of 2.5 times before the procedure, the surgery, and sometimes just before it, sometimes 2 days earlier. And it had this effect on blood flow, which is kind of an amazing thing for what we humans can do. What's going on with this? Okay. So as a result of this, Blue Shield of California decided that they would use this and just automatically dispense it to anybody who had signed up for surgery. At the time, again, this was in the late 90s, people just automatically got a call from a nurse. She sent out a CD and a cassette so they could pick which one they wanted. And they studied the survey data from 905 health plan members, and they did a separate retrospective study of 126 hysterectomy patients. So this we're finding consistently. The guided imagery had an adoption rate of 74% That's very similar to what Kaiser Permanente gets as well. And this is because people will do this before surgery who would never do it any other time. And that's a pretty good rate. So the guided imagery group had reduced anxiety, high patient satisfaction. We're not sure what the high patient satisfaction was really from, though, because they loved getting a weekly call from a nurse saying, how you doing? Any problems with the imagery? Got any questions? And they really felt cared for, and it was like one call a week. So there was a trend toward shorter hospital stays, and there was a trend toward reduced pharmaceutical costs, a 14% reduction. It wound up saving Blue Shield in $1,999, $2,003 per procedure. So that was good. I have a lot of studies here, and I'm going to skip around for some of them because, I don't want to step on other people's time. But if you add guided imagery to usual treatment for post-surgical home use for kids, teens, in acute pain, it works out pretty well. This is a pilot study with 40 adolescents with scoliosis. They underwent spinal fusion, had a lot of pain with it, they were assessed at discharge, then 2 weeks later than that, and then at 1 month follow-up on pain intensity, anxiety, coping, daily functioning. Now this is an interesting finding that the guided imagery plus group experienced significantly less overall pain at all time points, T1, T2, T3. The worst pain was moderately decreased at T2. On a 10-point scale median, however, there was a lot of improvement in daily functioning, in how much they ate, how much they slept, how well they slept, and walking. The things that weren't touched by this brief intervention was the state trade anxiety, and the coping strategies didn't seem to shift. Ventilator weaning. This study shows some wonderful results. The guided imagery improved oxygen saturation, it speeded up weaning, it reduced agitation, reduced the amount of sedation the person used and the length of stay. And impressively so. I recently just saw this study, but basically it improved agitation scores. You can see what we've got here. The guided imagery group required almost 5 less days of mechanical ventilation. And the guided imagery group had 1.4 days reduction in length of stay. Same day surgery, this was at Lackland Air Force Base, yielded similar results to the other stuff. Less anxiety, less pain, shorter length of stay, even though it was a day. Total knee replacement surgery. Again, this studies pain scores, gait velocity, and hair cortisol concentrations. And as I mentioned earlier today, it's interesting, this is a very brief intervention. And in spite of that, 6 months later, the hair cortisol levels were significantly changed. And there are other studies with similar findings, especially at that 6 month point, even with, an intervention that lasts 2 weeks, an intervention that lasts even 8 weeks, but still, I would not have expected that. These are kids and teens, teaching them guided imagery for pain management in an intensive care setting. 44 kids, I think they were ages 11 to 20, were randomized to one of two groups, guided imagery versus detailed inquiry. Detailed inquiry meaning, tell me about the pain, let's have her, well, you probably know about that better than I do, right? So the boys, this is an unusual finding, the boys benefited even more than the girls. They showed a significant decrease in average pain ratings as compared to the detailed inquiry. Some of them did much worse with the detailed inquiry. Most of the time, I don't think that kind of debriefing is helpful, especially in the case of traumatic accidents, which is what this was about, traumatic injuries. The girls also showed a decrease, but it was not significant. Guided imagery and chemo, I know Tveen and her colleagues are working on this, but basically, this was a study out of Greece. It was an RCT on comparing progressive muscle relaxation and guided imagery for reducing anxiety in breast and prostate cancer patients. So we had 236 patients assigned to one or the other group, and there was a significant reduction in anxiety with the guided imagery. I did not finish the sentence, as compared to the progressive muscle relaxation, and there were significant drops in cortisol and amylase levels. This is guided imagery being used to help patients with chronic illnesses sleep in the hospital, which, you know, sleep is daunting when you're not in the hospital, but for here. Now, if you'll see this here and there, autogenic training as opposed to guided imagery. Autogenic training is what guided imagery gets called a lot in different parts of Europe instead of guided imagery. But basically, it improved sleep by quite a bit. This was in London. Improvement, now this was 8 weeks of training and wound up being given to 153 patients. And time to sleep onset was improved. Time to fall asleep again after waking up in the middle of the night was nicely significant. Waking up refreshed, same thing. Waking up energized, not too shabby, and a sense of well-being, reduced anxiety, reduced depression, also looking good. This was just a study of veterans. I'm not even sure I need to, you know what, it's kind of old, but basically veterans who, from OIF, OEF, parts of the war, preferred relaxation. If they had to have a self-help, they said, what would you want? They said relaxation therapy, 72%, followed by medication, mindfulness training, which would probably be higher now because more people know what it is. And then these were the traditional techniques of cognitive awareness. You know, let me tell you about this stuff. Not so much. So. Here's just a general thing on guided imagery with surgery outcomes. And basically, it was a review of the published literature. I actually question, this was a fairly recent review, but I think there was a lot of stuff that they did not include that was qualified as an RCT. But basically, what they did come up with was, they found 8 studies that qualified of just sheer relaxation. And it showed partial support only for improvements in psychological well-being. It did not show any evidence for lower intake of medication. There were 8 studies of guided imagery that showed strong evidence for improvements in psychological well-being and moderate support for analgesic intake. And hypnosis, I don't understand this either, but hypnosis showed partial support for improvements in psychological well-being. So the guided imagery, the targeted imagery, seemed to perform well. Guided imagery and mindfulness together and separately decreased symptoms of acute depression. Now, this is a surprise to me. I would not have expected this to be the case. I would not recommend guided imagery for acute depression. But go figure, it worked out pretty well. This was a randomized, controlled pre-post study with acutely depressed subjects. The symptoms of depression were significantly decreased by both mindfulness meditation and guided imagery. The changes were maintained at follow-up. Self-regulatory functioning increased, and both practices instigated reductions in symptoms. Okay. There are a lot of studies of depression with fibromyalgia patients, arthritis patients, IBS patients. They all look good. This is an exciting study because this is a combination of two integrative therapies. This is using guided imagery and healing touch, what's considered a biofield intervention that's like Reiki, but with some touch to it. So this was with a group of Marines from Camp Pendleton who were between deployments. They had 3 weeks to get something for themselves, and they all exhibited severe symptoms of post-traumatic stress. And so they decided, this was Mimi Guarneri, decided that they would do a combination of healing touch twice a week, six sessions, and they would add guided imagery to it. They wanted to add it's most effective, but it's the most intense imagery for post-traumatic stress. And I recommended they not do it, that it would trigger a lot of these Marines, and they only had 3 weeks, and to start with something a little bit more emotionally neutral. And they went ahead and used the guided imagery for post-traumatic stress. And it turns out they were right, that the healing touch was so powerfully relaxing and centering and calming that they got the benefit of the guided imagery, probably more so because they were even more relaxed, and nobody was triggered by it. So they got some pretty stunning results. So, significant reduction in all three clusters of post-traumatic stress symptoms in the guided imagery healing touch group. Very, very large effect sizes. Significant reduction in depression, which is a separate issue altogether. It doesn't always come out that both improve. Sometimes just PTS improves. Statistically and clinically significant reduction in depression. Also, same big effect size. Improvement in quality of life, improvement in cynicism on that anger scale as compared to the treatment as usual group. And this also had this halo effect of making these Marines feel more connected to their health care and more connected to the whole authority structure with which they were somewhat disillusioned before. Okay. So I could go on and on, but instead I want to quickly go to something else. I want to talk about some of the ideas that some of the comparisons we can make between different kinds of mind-body interventions, because so often they're all clustered together, and we're actually learning something about each one and how to distinguish them. So for instance, conscious breathing, simple mantra meditation, these are the simplest, most accessible things, and they're immediately helpful, especially for somebody who is in crisis. So immediately after an accident, getting people off the mound at 9/11, during 9/11, after 9/11, people who have just been raped. This kind of conscious breathing, simple mantra repetition is really powerful and probably a best practice. And so for high stress work, like with EMTs and in the ER, that is a good thing to do. And it's kind of, I'm always surprised at how well it works myself, even though I know it does, but it's just shocking the way it can tune the channel someplace else. The negatives are, it's boring. If you're not in a complete messy state, it may not hold your attention. It alleviates symptoms, but it doesn't achieve any kind of healing. It just gets you back to center. And it's less helpful for emotionally complex situations. Body scanning, progressive relaxation. Basically the same thing, only it's a little bit more complicated. But the same things apply. It will capture a little bit more attentional focus, and it is a more grounding experience to be sort of directed into your body. Mindfulness meditation. Powerful tool to ease suffering, cope with difficulty, get perspective on suffering and pain. It's probably amazing for emotional balance. Teaches concentration and focus. It allows people to access their spiritual gateways. It increases patience and compassion for self and others. I think it's probably a hugely ethical practice that builds character. And it's versatile. It suits anything. It's available for anything, and it applies. The negatives are, it requires a certain amount of discipline and practice and structure, and not everybody's willing to do that. It can take time to achieve a certain skill level. And motivation can slip away. And it's a technique that, rather than provide distraction from distress, it teaches you how to enter your distress and face up to it, face it, and notice it, and then let it drift away. Powerful, but not easy for everybody. Some people are really after distraction. So, all the moving meditations, forgive me for clustering them all together. Each one is so fabulous and deserves its own mention. But basically, this is like the perfect treatment of choice for the fidgeters and the people who hate sitting still, and for the people who are completely body-based. I've got two daughters-in-law that have to be moving outside like at least twice a day. This is what they can use. It's just good for the body in other ways, so it's pretty compelling. And it does create this wonderful relocation of focus of attention to the stretch, to the breathing, to all the physical things you need to do, so that it does clear the mind. The cons, it's not appealing to everybody. Some people don't like to move, feel klutzy, may have problems with coordination and balance. It requires physical space. It takes more time generally, although you can learn some pretty quick tricks sitting at your computer too. It's basically about overcoming resistance to moving in those people who have it. Biofield therapies, I'm running out of time. I think I should, let me just say very quickly, I'm gonna get through with this, but biofield therapies, it's very effective for resetting the body, and you don't have to do anything. You get done to in this wonderful way, that even if you have any question about it to start with, you end up being soul, just like those Marines. It feels inherently rewarding to do. It works so well with guided imagery and other meditative techniques. It's just a natural collaborator with them. It makes you more open, more receptive, more immersed in whatever it is you're getting. And most people are willing to try it. So it requires a trustworthy, trained practitioner. It sometimes they're hard to find. And sometimes it's more expensive than self-administered, although there are a ton of people doing volunteer pro bono, healing touch, and other things. So biofeedback and neurofeedback, great for the people who want physical proof on a screen or on some kind of mechanical device that shows them they have gone from A to B. Guided imagery, I'm a total fan and completely biased, so let's not even go there. Okay, just some quick tips. Put imagery on the phone lines, so when people are on hold, they can sample it. Put it on the TV in the patient rooms for people to check it out. Help them with anxiety and their sleep issues. Offer it on tablets that are attached to the bed. And you probably already do. Upload clips of imagery, breathing exercises, walking meditation to your patient's smartphone. Sometimes they're intimidated by that still. So do it for them and show them how to use it. If people are technically challenged, offer them a playaway, which is a preloaded MP3 player. You pass it around a little bit. Makes it very easy. There's one selection. You say, you need this for your depression, and you just hand it to them. That's all it is. And for people with brain challenges like TBI, it's simple and easy and doable. If you open it, can you open it? There you go. And if you turn it over, you'll see the players on the other side. It's very cool. They're practically indestructible, so you see them in libraries all the time. I'm gonna stop here, because let me just show you one last thing, and I promise I'll stop. Okay, so this is a sample portal page. We finally figured out how to do this. So you can pick, let's say you have a selection of people on the oncology floor. You want them to get help with chemo and radiation therapy and stress and cancer treatment-related fatigue. So you just pick those things and you make them available to them, and they get a passcode, and it they can find this, you can prescribe it, and they can find it night or day. We do it this way. We have an app that allows you to load either Apple products or Androids, but you can do the same. This is what Kaiser Permanente had for their portal page. And basically they just offered titles they thought people needed. I think they offer about 21 or 22. That's all I'm gonna do, because I'm stepping on other people's time. But I thank you so much for being here.
Have some time. I'm sure we've got time, and remember, we've got time for discussion at the end of the session after the other speakers. But if we have a couple of pressing questions now, anybody?
You just get out of here. Sorry, I'm just technically challenged and yeah. Okay. Yes.
You mentioned one study in which you reported 6 months later they still show benefits after only 2 weeks of training.
Yes, right? So, and that's not the only one either.
So my question is, do you think that it was that 2 weeks of training that carried over to the 6 months, or do you think once they learn these tools, they continue to use these throughout the 6 months?
I think people do it, especially if they do it when they're very anxious. It really sears into their brains, and they find themselves hearing the voice or speaking to themselves in the same language. But the truth is, that was a pilot study, and I think there were only 58 subjects, and I wish we had something bigger that could look at that, because it could have been a bunch of things. But yeah, I think that's what they do. I think it really goes in, and they hear things, or see images, or experience images.
You're out for 6 months.
Yeah.
Okay, one brief one. For practitioners who would like to learn guided imagery and incorporate it into their work, what kind of training do you offer?
I don't do any regular training anymore, but I think the Academy for Guided Imagery does. I think there's a nurses group that has expanded to include other healthcare practitioners called Imagery International that does it. There's a Helen Bonney kind of guided imagery in music that's amazing. It's sort of, it's the music that generates the images, but that's a brilliant process too.
Can you repeat that? The one for the nurses and the one?
It's called Imagery International.
And the one for music?
It's the Bonney method, B-O-N-N-Y method, and it's called Guided Imagery and Music. It's really music and guided imagery.
So thank you, and please stay till the end of the session, because we're going to have some more time with our speakers to discuss generally, and I think, how would we want to use this here for our patients? So I'd now like to introduce Dr. Marc Weigensberg, our Associate Professor of Clinical Pediatrics and the Chair or Co-Chair of the USC Institute for Integrative Health. And he's going to talk about his work with prevention and treatment of diabetes and young people using guided imagery. Okay, I'm going to just introduce Tom Jackwitz, who's the Senior Vice President and CEO of USC System, who is here.
So I'm not going to cut into Mark's time very long, but I did want to say how important today is. And I will tell you, as someone, and on a very personal level, about 3 years ago, I had a very, very bad case of Bell's palsy. And Dr. Love was here, and Dr. Love knows, because it first kind of came on during a department chairs meeting. Not that the meeting itself was too wild or anything. But one of the things I use, and part of my treatment, I actually had acupuncture twice a week, and I meditated. And part of the recovery, and I remember this, and I was part of a clinical trial on ENT. And I got to read their notes later, and of course they didn't really ever tell me how bad it really was, because I couldn't close my eye. And they were worried that I wouldn't be able to close my eye again. But it turns out, as part of this, there was a recommendation from one of the physicians that said, well, acupuncture works for some patients, why don't you give it a try? And I was religious about it, I went twice a week, sometimes three times a week. And I made a full recovery within 6 months. So for me, this is very personal and very important. So I think it's, as we think about where healthcare is going to go with population health, value-based care, this is going to be a key component of it. I have a very personal experience about it, but I also believe that healthcare, sort of, if you will, academic medicine, healthcare, and healthcare in general is going to embrace integrative medicine as an important part of treatment plans. So thank you, and thank you for being here today. Sorry, Mark.
No. Thank you, Kevin. It's great to hear those sorts of testimonials, too. And in terms of academic medicine, yes, I am the director of our Institute for Integrative Health here, but you all should know that there's a consortium of academic centers for integrative health and medicine across the country, Canada and Mexico, now consists of 69 institutions. We're talking about Harvard, Yale, Stanford, UCSF, University of Arizona. USC, a little behind the curve, we're the 52nd to join of the 69 centers, but we joined. We're there, and so we're really happy to be able to co-sponsor events like this and to see such a great turnout. And I just have to say before I start that Belleruth was one of my heroes in guided imagery. I was certified in guided imagery by the Academy for Guided Imagery, which is located in Los Angeles, and they have a great training program. It's quite rigorous. They offer certification, so Belleruth can mention them, and I would recommend them as well if you really want to learn to do this work. I was telling Belleruth earlier that I still very clearly remember one image that I got when she led a keynote group of about 300 people in a guided imagery, and to this day, this was 1996. And to this day, I remember the image I got on that day, and it's still an internal motivator of mine. So I can also testify, as Tom just did, to the power of some of these modalities. So I'm really happy to be able to share with you this next segment of the symposium, myself and then Tveen and Lisa when they come up. We want to share with you some of the things that are happening right here at USC in terms of guided imagery. And what I'm going to share with you is some of my research on using guided imagery as part of a lifestyle intervention in obese adolescent teenagers, and also in some young adults with type 1 diabetes, and some of the early studies, results we've seen in our pilot studies, and just fill you in on a larger study that's going on. Am I getting too close?
Yeah, I think that's the problem.
I tend to talk too loud sometimes. Okay, yes. Can you hear me with this?
So is it Weigensberg or Weigensberg? That's what I want to know.
Oh, yeah. Well, you know, if you're of German descent, it should be pronounced Weigensberg. But, you know, how these things happen. You come to the new world. So my family told me it's pronounced Weigensberg. But I respond to anything close. Not to work. Okay, so I always have a no disclosure slide, but I recently went to Greece and spent 2 weeks. So here's my only disclosure. It comes from Socrates. The only thing I know is that I don't know anything. And what I find is that, you know, the further I get in medicine, the less sure I am of anything I've ever learned, truly. That, and I think that's one of the wonderful things about medicine and health and healing. Oops. So this is very touchy for us. We may not have any images. Okay. I'm unplugging from you. Is that the further I go, the more mysterious it all is. Just like that. I mean, you just doing a talk for you. It takes a while. Okay, I'm trying to think of the next slide. The next slide, imagine in your mind a picture of Albert Einstein. Okay, so Albert Einstein. So these are the two of the smartest people that ever lived in the world, right? Socrates, whatever, 300-400 BCE, and Albert Einstein in the 20th century. So Albert Einstein, the quote is, imagination is more important than knowledge. And there's a whole quote too, I have it there, but it basically says something to the effect of imagination can embrace the whole world. And so I just find it really interesting that two of these wise ones are really telling us that we should be humble about what we think we know. Because we don't always know what we know. And in fact, the Oracle at Delphi, they went to the Oracle at Delphi and said, who is the wisest person in the world? And the Oracle said, Socrates. And it turns out that Socrates interpreted that just as I told you. Well, my wisdom is that I know I don't know things, and all those other people who think they're wise think they know things. That's the only reason I'm wise. Okay. So the problem I'm going to speak about is primarily I'm going to show you our pilot studies in childhood obesity and trying to prevent type 2 diabetes. And the reason I think that I thought initially that guided imagery would be useful for this is because it is a great stress reduction tool. And there's a lot of literature linking chronic stress with obesity development, number one. And if you have obesity, then it links you to more insulin resistance and more morbidity and complications from that obesity. So more risk for type 2 diabetes, more risk for metabolic syndrome and future heart disease. So this has been known in adults since the 90s. And now some of the work our lab did actually showed links between things like cortisol levels and metabolic syndrome in obese kids. So kids who are obese and have higher cortisol levels tended to have more metabolic syndrome, risk factor for cardiovascular disease, and also more risk factor for intima media thickening of the carotid artery. So this is felt to be a precursor for carotid vascular disease, so chronic life stress relating to that, and cortisol levels. So we're looking at the cortisol biomarker. Yay, thank you. I gotta be really careful here. Yeah. Remote control. There's Albert. All right. Yes. So we talked about Albert. And here is the link. Chronic stress can lead to altered eating behaviors. And you know, when people are stressed and they're stress eaters or emotional eaters, they don't eat properly. right? I mean, you know, you go for the pasta, you go for the, you know, the high caloric, you know, stuff. So it tends to increase adiposity. And also then with chronic stress and activation of the hypothalamic pituitary axis or HPA axis, this leads to condition has been called subtle Cushingoid syndrome, so subtle hypercortisolism. It's not where it's a level that we see with pathology with Cushing's disease, but it does increase visceral adiposity, so adiposity in the abdomen, which is more risk for insulin resistance, which is a primary risk factor for going on to develop type 2 diabetes. I'm going to skip this. These are some of our data that our research group has shown in Latino adolescents, so you can quickly scan it. But some of the data that we showed that, yes, in adolescents and in inner city youth, that indeed some of these relationships between stress biomarkers and chronic disease risk are there. And the last one is just there's actually an interaction. If you're stressed and you eat high sugar, you're in really trouble because that tends to particularly increase visceral adiposity. So that led to a series of studies that we did, I'm going to be discussing, which I call the Imagine Health Studies. And you know, every good study needs a good acronym. So HEALTH stands for Healthy Eating, Active Living, and Total Health. And the overarching research question here was, if you can interrupt that chronic stress to disease pathway, then can you reduce the incidence of the chronic disease? And specifically, since I was trained and certified in guided imagery, I was interested in this. Can it reduce the diabetes risk that's linked to obesity and insulin resistance? So here's my slide on what is guided imagery. Mental images, and I qualify that, as Belleruth did, not necessarily pictures, but some sensory image or affective feeling state that will lead to a specific health outcome. So it can be stress reduction, it can be pain relief, it can be improved mobility, whatever. It has been shown to be effective in children in quite a number of different studies. Now, the type of imagery that the Academy for Guided Imagery teaches is a little different than Belleruth was describing. So it's called interactive guided imagery. And that's what I've used in these studies. And what this imagery does is actually invites the subject to form their own images. So rather than giving them an image, which you then walk them through, you actually invite them to form an image that will come up for them. And then the Academy, or the interactive guided imagery, is basically taught as a one-on-one. So you as the imagery facilitator are in the image and guiding them through the image. They're talking to you about what's going on in the image. And so you can actually guide them, and that gives you a lot of power to really up the ante on their experience. And because the image comes from them, it's very salient to them. It has particular meaning for them personally and individually. So it really lets you get at what's going on in the unconscious or in the mind-body of the subject. So, and it's really well suited for adolescents because they don't want you to give them your image. They want their own image, right? You're a teenager, you know. So, and actually that was our first question. We're working with Latino inner city adolescents, and most of the work in guided imagery is not in that population. So our first study, we call Imagine Health 1, was a tiny little pilot grant funded by USC, an internal mechanism. And the first thing we said was, will they even sit there and do this, you know, with an older adult guiding them, closing their eyes, sitting and relaxing and going. And I was very gratified to find out that they did like it. They really enjoyed it. The breath, the progressive muscle relaxation, which we use, as well as the imagery exercises. And what we saw, this was not a well-controlled study, so I'll show you other data later, but we did see an acute drop within a 45-minute session of guided imagery in their salivary cortisol, but we didn't really have a good control group. So we went on to the next study, which was funded by the NIH, NCAM, NCCAM, National Center for Complementary Alternative Medicine. Now it's called NCCIH, Center for Complementary and Integrative Health. Everyone's changing their names. So this was a pilot study, and this is just the conceptual framework of the study, that we're going to do a 12-week guided imagery intervention for two purposes. One is to lead to stress reduction, which may lead to changes in behavior. If we reduce stress, we might get a decrease in overeating, an increase in physical activity, and therefore a decrease in insulin resistance. Or we might actually change some of the meanings of the behaviors, change eating behaviors. So those people who don't like to move, maybe they kind of get a motivation within themselves to why they would like to move, why they'd like to exercise, or why they'd like to eat healthier. And then that might change their behavior, and that might reduce their obesity and insulin resistance. So that's the conceptual framework behind it. So we had guided imagery, we developed guided imagery for those two purposes. So we had some standard guided imagery exercises. Starting the first lesson was focused breathing, progressive muscle relaxation, relaxed place imagery. This was kind of the key imagery, very straightforward. You go in, you relax all your muscles, and then you invite an image to form of a place that represents just comfort and relaxation for you. And then the image would come and we'd explore it and recruit all the senses and feel the feelings associated with being in there. And then we did 9 weeks of behavior change imagery. So we did things like hunger, fullness, doing imagery, inviting an image that represents how full you are. So this is kind of an element of mindful eating. If you've read any of the mindful eating literature, this is using guided imagery in a mindful eating way. So really becoming aware of your sense of fullness and satisfaction with your meal. So we would teach the kids, you know, when you're about 3/4 through your meal, stop for a minute, take a pause. I know none of us in this audience tend to overdo it or overindulge, but you know, take a pause, check in, invite your image. You know, kids would get images like a balloon, how full it was, or a glass of water, how full it was, or my image when we did with the kids was a dump truck, and how full was the dump truck? And then you can do it after the, and I always tell my kids in clinic too, after you finish the meal, check in before you go get your seconds. You know, because it takes a while for the hunger and fullness signals to get to the brain and your body to physiologically recognize that you're full, and that meal that your mom just made tastes really good, and you want more, but maybe your body doesn't really need more. Give yourself the time and mindfulness to check into that. We did some healthy eating imagery where they actually imagine themselves eating healthily and all the feelings that they had as they took in good healthy foods, and same thing with being active and being physically active. And then we did a very powerful imagery exercise called inner advisor imagery, one of the key imagery exercises in the Academy's Academy for Guided Imagery program, which really is about inviting an image of an inner guide or an inner advisor, somebody who really knows you. It really gets at, you know, we all have kind of an intuitive wisdom within ourselves that we know things that sometimes rationally left brain we might not be always conscious of. So this is a way to take a step back, invite that inner wisdom to come forward. And it's very empowering to know that you have some wisdom in you that maybe you can tap into. So this was just a slide to remind me to stop and have us all take a breath. We've talked a lot about guided imagery. You want to do a 1 minute guided imagery exercise?
Yeah. All
right. It actually is helpful to do that so that, you know, you can talk about all you want. What is guided imagery? If you do it for a minute or two, you got it, you know. So I think what we'll do, I'll just guide you in a very simple, relaxed placing. It's just very straightforward. If you're one of those people who panics when you close your eyes and that sort of thing, let me know. Okay. Most people are just fine with this. So after a little breathing, I'll just, you'll hear my voice say, go to a place that represents just comfort and relaxation for you. And we'll give you a little minute for that to show up, and then I'll guide you through that, okay? So I invite you to close your eyes if you're comfortable with that, or if not, just let your focus dim as you look ahead, move in the chair if you need to get more comfortable. And begin by just focusing on your breath. Breathing in, breathing out, letting all of the thoughts go for just the next minute or two while we do this. Breathing in, breathing out, just noticing already, just with a few cycles of breath, your body may be more relaxed than it was just a moment ago. And if thoughts come in and intrude and distract you, just kind of notice them non-judgmentally, just sort of see them, and then let them go for a moment. You can even blow them out with the next out breath, so that you return just to focusing on the breath. Breathing in and breathing out. Just allowing your bodies to relax. If you notice any parts of your body that you're breathing that are a little bit tense, you can actually direct the breath directly there. And let that fresh air that you're breathing in kind of wash away that part of your body that's a little bit tense, and when you breathe out, it'll take the muscle tension away. Breathing out. And over the next breath or two, invite an image to form that represents a place of just comfort and relaxation for you. It may be a place you know from your waking world that you've been to before, or it may be a place that comes right out of your imagination right now. But just know whatever image forms represents just comfort and relaxation. You keeping your eyes closed and just seeing the image as it forms, when it appears, just for me, raise your hand just briefly so that I kind of get a sense of where everybody's at. So if the image is there, just stay with it. And if it's not there, that's okay. Just stay inviting and open to it. It may pop in at any moment during the course of this exercise. And even if it doesn't, you just stay with your breath, and that may be your image for this time. But if the image is there, just kind of see what you see. What do you notice about it visually? What colors are there? Maybe what time of day it is? You might be able to tell that from the light. Is it evening? Is it morning? Is there sunlight? Notice if there are any sounds associated with the image. Might even be some smells or aromas. Just take note of that now. And notice if you have any tactile sensation. Maybe there's a breeze or the temperature that's present. You might notice even if you're in the image. And if so, what do you look like in the image? Where are you? Just notice how your body appears, what your posture is. Now just take note of how your body is feeling as you are in this image. Just notice any sensation of comfort, relaxation, calm, centeredness, or balance. And over the next breath or two, you might even let those feelings of comfort and calm with each breath kind of amplify just a bit so that you really fully experience them. As you're fully present in this place, that is a place of comfort and relaxation. For the sake of time, we can let the image gently fade, knowing that you can invite it back anytime you want, just by closing your eyes, taking a few breaths, and inviting this image right back. And when you're ready, over the next breath or two, just becoming more aware of your place back here in this room, feeling of your body in the chair, your voice, knowing there are other people around you, and when you're ready, you can gently open your eyes and be fully present. Anyone have anyone feel more relaxed now than they did before we started the first classes? Okay. Anyone feel less relaxed? Maybe more tends to have that kind of paradoxical negative reaction. Good. I like when we don't lose anyone in that way too. All right. So that's kind of the standard relaxation exercise or stress reduction exercise we did. So we did a few sessions of that, and then we did some of the other behavioral stuff. This was just some focus group. You know, if you want to know how the kids responded to it, yeah, I got into it, but in the beginning it was kind of weird. Most of these kids were totally mind-body naive. They'd never done anything. They'd never meditated, they'd never done yoga, they'd never done imagery or relaxed, nothing, you know. It helped me when I was stressed out in school. I started doing it and I would feel better. So this was really interesting. They took it out into their lives. So it wasn't just about the program. And they taught their siblings and they taught their parents. It was really interesting. The fullness symbol. So the fullness symbol is, you know, people use hunger fullness scales from 1 to 10. Higher meaning you're really full. So a 10 is after Thanksgiving dinner when you really just had, you know, that extra piece of pumpkin pie you know you didn't eat it and you just got to lay on the floor. You know, and the 0 is, or 1, you're so hungry, you're famished, you let it go 2, you're really empty. And so the idea is you kind of modulate between the 3 and the 7. When you're 3, you're hungry enough to eat. When you're 7 or 8, you're full enough, you're satisfied. So the fullness symbol was really just an image that represented that, as I told you. And so some of them, as you see, it helped, blah, blah, blah. Now I just stop eating. One girl, she was going to tell her brother to teach her how to surf. And the inner advisor image was powerful, although, again, it was weird for them at first to think about getting inside and that they have internal wisdom that they can tap into. Oh, my goodness. Okay. 10 minutes more, I'm going to fly through these. This was our pilot study then. We did a 12-week, once-a-week lifestyle education, obese Latino kids, about 30, 15 in each group, 14 to 15. The intervention group got 12 sessions of guided imagery. The lifestyle education was about healthy eating and being more physically active, a didactic class. And the other group got the same lifestyle, and then they got computer storytelling. It's kind of, we were talking earlier about that vision board idea where you cut and paste images to make a story, but they did it through iMovie, so they made it. So it's kind of an imagery-based, non-health-based control group, which I thought was interesting. So just a couple quick data slides. The guided imagery group shown in the dark bar. These are changes in salivary cortisol across individual 45-minute sessions of guided imagery. The first three sessions were stress reduction. The first session was the breathing only. And what we saw was an average of about almost 40% lower salivary cortisol across a 45-minute session, so just that short. So what you guys just did for 2-3 minutes, if we did that, the imagery I did with them actually was about 20 minutes. The whole session was 45, a little bit leading into the imagery, 20 minutes of imagery, and then some coming out. And so about all three sessions that we did dedicated to stress reduction got significant drops in cortisol. This slide shows over the course of the 12-week intervention, change in physical activity. So you see in the first little set of columns there, the guided imagery group, this is sedentary activity, this is couch potato behavior. So it was significantly reduced in the guided imagery group dark bar relative to the open bar control group, and moderate physical activity was increased relative to the control. We actually showed a decrease. We didn't see a change in vigorous physical activity. So that was our pilot data. We published that in, I forget the year, 2014, I think it led to this. Then we're funded and we're in the middle of this study now, which is a larger study, bigger scale. We're at four high schools around the USC area here in East LA. 60 kids in each of the four intervention arms. One is really a no intervention control. The other one gets the lifestyle class only that I told you about, a didactic health education class. One group gets the lifestyle class and stress reduction imagery only for 12 weeks. So the question there is stress reduction enough with the health information? Or do you have to go further and give both stress reduction, SRG, and behavioral? So the fullness symbols, the healthy eating imagery, the health, the being active imagery, the inner advisor. So this is the study we're in the middle of. I don't have any outcome data to show you except a little bit from pilot data. We're measuring outcomes at 12 weeks. It's a 12-week intervention, once-a-week sessions with them for the guided imagery. And then they get a once-a-month booster class for 6 months, so we're measuring outcomes after that. And then 6 more months of no contact. I didn't want to do that, but NIH made me do it. They want to know long-term, and I think it's a good idea. But now, this is group guided imagery, though. This is not the one-on-one, because that is cost prohibitive to have a single, you know, because we're doing 240 kids to have 240 times 12 individual sessions. So we're going to deliver the imagery in a group, and we're using a format called Council, which I've been familiar with for many other ways. It's based on indigenous people, tribal practices, if you would. Sort of like the tribe, the elders, the Council of Elders making a decision for the village. In this continent, Native American, but also Africa, Indonesia, any culture around the world has used this. It's a way that promotes really deep conversation. So it's really good for delivering guided imagery because the kids come in and they're in council where they sit in a circle. The only one who's allowed to speak is the one who's holding what we call a talking piece. It can be a stick, it can be a stone, it can be a pen, it doesn't matter. But it's given the power that the speaker speaks from the heart and everyone else is empowered to listen. This is a very different way of discourse and communication that the kids, you know, really dug it because they said, and I think I got some focus group data, they never talk like this. There's always crosstalk, you know, whenever their conversation in school. And so this is a way to really get very quickly focused, and so then we can deliver the group guided imagery. This council technique, by the way, is being used in LA school district. And they've shown improved school behavior, and they've shown improved academic performance. And they're using it in all levels of the school now. They started in middle schools, now they've brought counsel into elementary and into high schools. So what we did before we launched that big four-arm study was we just piloted this group-guided imagery because we needed to know a couple things. Would the kids do the counsel? Would they sit? And could we deliver the group-guided imagery? And would we get the same sort of stress reduction and do a group guided imagery as we do with the individual? We didn't know that. Fortunately, we found out the kids liked the group. They liked how it was. You can see some of their sample quotes there. We did focus groups. They felt really the council fostered trust, respect. It let us really deliver the guided imagery in a good way. And again, they were applying the skills outside. They were taking it home and teaching their siblings and their parents how to do this stuff. In terms of salivary cortisol data, we just did six weekly sessions in this little pilot before we launched the big study. it's a kind of a busy slide. I'll just have you focus on these three sessions, the first sessions, 1, 2, and 3. These were hour and a quarter sessions. We did the same thing. We measured salivary cortisol before the session and then right after. So this is the change in cortisol across that hour and a quarter. And for each of the three sessions, first three that were dedicated to stress reduction, you see that it was decreased. Later sessions were about the behavioral imagery, and we got less consistent drops. That was fine, and you know, we didn't really. So we got about a 30% reduction in salivary cortisol, and it was significant across the three sessions in the group. So that was really important to show, right, that we could get the effect with the group. So that's where we're at with that study. Next year, around this time, we'll be finishing the intervention next May, and hopefully by the end of the summer, we'll have the database all clean and sorted, and I can come and present you some of the data on the bigger study. I just wanted a couple more slides. This is on, we did the council with a group of 18 to 25 year olds with type 1 diabetes. A lot of literature showing that stress adversely affects blood sugar control, not only in type 2 diabetes, but in type 1. Two ways. One is, as Belleruth mentioned, biochemically, you know, cortisol elevated from stress, epinephrine tends to raise blood sugars, right? And secondly, if a kid with diabetes, when they're in chronic stress, they don't take as good control of themselves or good care of themselves. They might omit insulin. They might not test their blood sugar as often. So a couple ways that that stress is related. But this was a really holistic and very multimodal intervention. Within the council group, again, we did stress reduction guided imagery. We did a lot of narrative storytelling. There's this idea that if you tell your health story to a group that's listening, that actually is a healing modality. So I'm a firm proponent of group shared medical appointments, and I'm developing some in my clinical practice over at County Hospital. We did some poetry, music, etc. So this was about, they met 12 times over about 9 months. As a group, and again, the focus group showed that they really liked it. They trusted the group. We all felt equal within the circle. It gets away in the hierarchy of here's the doctor up here telling the patient down here what to do. You know, we're all in the circle together, and we all have an equal role within that. And as I tell my patients, I may have some expertise in diabetes, but they have the expertise in their diabetes, the illness as it is within them, and I can't presume to know most of the time what's the best thing to tell them to do, but they need to discover it themselves. Okay, so they felt safe in the group. All that's really important. So we did see these are changes in perceived stress, depression, and well-being. Perceived stress was reduced in the diabetes group. This was a small pilot study, but we got good effect sizes in each of these, 0.8 to 0.9. This is a large effect, and either significant as in the term of depression symptoms here, or near significance in terms of p-values, which right now this paper is in review. And this was really exciting for me as an endocrinologist, that this showed that the change in perceived stress correlated with the change in hemoglobin A1C across the 1 year of intervention. So in other words, if their stress went down with the intervention, their glycemic control was better. All right, so again, reinforcing that link between chronic stress. And I just want to close with a few, just to kind of cast some things out there, a few personal anecdotes of when I've used guided imagery just in my clinical practice. So all of these are potentially open to research studies. So some of them do have research behind them. But the first one is Frank. He has type 1 diabetes. He doesn't check his sugars a lot or emits insulin. He said, because I'm lazy. So what I did with him was a quick guided imagery in clinic in a 15-minute session. I call, what kind of animal are you? And I say, if you were an animal, what would you be? And close your eyes and invite an image to form. And for him, it was one of these Komodo dragons. And I thought, wow, that's a really powerful image, right? He said, no, it's a really lazy dragon. I'm so lazy, I don't want to check my blood sugars. I don't want to get my insulin. It's just sitting out in the sun. Well, then we had a little discussion about, well, dragons can be quite powerful also, right? And so he sort of considered that. So I don't know how much effect this particular imagery exercise helped, but I would just say that he's doing better now, all right? So I don't know what we can attribute to the imagery or whatnot. I think Belleruth mentioned studies on chemotherapy, using it with chemotherapy. I've had a couple of patients that my oncologist has asked me to work with, one in particular here who was just having almost panic episodes every time he got his chemo infused. And with just a single stress reduction guided imagery, similar to what I just did with you, a relaxed place, he never had that issue again. Chronic abdominal pain. It's been shown for functional abdominal pain in pediatrics, a randomized study, clearly effective. This kid had gone the whole route of, you know, the big GI work, upper GI, lower GI, CAT scan. He was actually losing weight. Very anxious kid, very anxious mother. I think that was really the problem. But, you know, it certainly reinforced. And I taught him some guided imagery, stress reduction, nine-year-old, you know, even. He also got some ongoing counseling through the psychology department and was doing much better. And then this one was a 16-year-old girl, classic chest pain palpitation symptoms of hyperventilation, but she was admitted to the hospital. You know, they did EKG and all that stuff. Well, 16-year-old, you know, 16-year-old chest pain is a lot different than a 57-year-old overweight man with chest pain. That, you know, the incidence of that's cardiac is well below 5%, but nonetheless, she had been admitted. And she had the great foresight to have a panic episode as we were rounding in the morning. So we walked into the room, because the residents were telling me, oh, she's better, you know. Well, this sounds like I was ward attending. It's classic hyperventilation panic. So there she is, sweating, palpitating, tachycardic. And I just did a very simple, you know, about 2 minute, talking her through breath, relaxation, heart rate came down there. And, you know, so these are, and I think that was mentioned by Belleruth also, anxiety episodes and panic. And some of the ways that guided imagery, just in my everyday world, sometimes you can just throw some in there. So it's really a good tool to have. It works a lot better than telling a panicking 16-year-old, just breathe slower. You know, usually doesn't happen. Yeah, relax, what's wrong with you? Sir, I'll just close with Einstein again. He's one of my favorite philosophers. So, and this is the sunrise over a Greek island, so very beautiful in the Aegean Sea. So thank you very much. That's kind of what we're doing in the realms that I inhabit.